Thank you. Good evening. It's 6 o'clock, second Sunday of the month, and we've had some wonderful jazz throughout the year. This is our next to the last Jazz Vespers for this year. Next month, it will be not the second Sunday, but the first Sunday, and I will be playing with my wife singing and another friend of mine singing, and piano and piano, bass, and drums, a trio with two singers, doing some Christmas songs where you can join in and have a good time. So tonight, as we get started, I'm going to ask Reverend Steve to come up and do the scripture for us.
Christmas? Is it here already? Christmas, guys? It is the middle of November, isn't it? Close, yeah. Okay, scripture today comes from, if you look in your bulletins, all those strange little places. That's because this section is odd, but it makes sense the way I put it together. During supper, Jesus rose from the table, laid aside his garments, and taking a towel, tied it round him. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel. After washing their feet and taking his garments again, he sat down. "Do you understand," he asked, "what I have done for you? You call me Master and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Then if I, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. I have set you an example. You are to do as I have done for you. I give you a new commandment. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you are to love one another." We'll come back and talk about that.
And Barbara, will you come up and put the tonight's artist?
Hi, it's my pleasure tonight to introduce Jennifer Gunlock, and I hope that if you didn't get a chance to talk with her on your way in, that on your way out you'll stop and look at her work and talk with her about what she's doing. And I've known her for a while and have been really enjoying watching her grow. She's with Gallery 825, and she's a wonderful artist, and I'm going to let her talk a little bit about what she's doing. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Jennifer Gunlock, fellow member of Gallery 825, and I'm thankful to be here tonight, so thank you. And I think this is a fantastic format to fuse music and art together, because we are cousins, and each medium speaks in a way that the other doesn't, so the world is incomplete without either. So I love this. I've noticed a quote in here on the program, which I just immediately related to, which is the Miles Davis quote. "Sometimes you have to play a long time to be able to play like yourself." And that absolutely applies to fine art as well. That was the case with me. I wasn't one of those kids that was prodigious from the beginning. I didn't even declare myself an artist until college. I think I was kind of hiding behind, well, I'm not, you know, obviously talented. So, but I just sort of subtly kind of, I was just sort of made that way, I guess, sort of subtly in the background, kind of doodling and drawing and loving it and just not opening myself to share it. But what I'm doing now is a collage and drawing, kind of fusing buildings and trees together in this kind of push-pull sort of awkward relationship between civilization and nature. One is always, I think humanity is trying to dominate, own the planet, take over, build on top, and Mother Earth is saying, not so much. So I'm trying to make the two work together. We are a family, we're working together, but not necessarily so harmoniously. How I got to that point, which is where the Miles Davis quote comes in, was that when I was in art school, I was painting, kind of abstract painting, just sort of pushing the paint around, and I'd kind of come up with this sort of tree-ish shape, and it kept happening again and again, and then I would make these architectural square kind of marks. So I'm like, well, I think I just need to accept it, acknowledge it, and bring it forward, rather than just some expressionistic mark, explore those things further and more deeply. And that's how, after school, when I moved into my apartment and couldn't throw paint around anymore because my apartment just couldn't do that, I was starting to apply actual photographs and drawing, and then it eventually came to what's happening now. These trees that I'm creating, these kind of architect conic tree things, kind of reference a tree house, an old temple, a tomb, an ancient old place, something that may have grown there for eons and eons. There may have been a civilization there in the past that kind of crumbled and wore down, and the forest took over and grew over it. So the past, the present, the future, these ancient things that are quietly alive, quietly watching, listening. So the work I brought here tonight is probably from the last few years, between 2010 and 2012. Work I'm doing now is quite a bit larger. I'm working bigger and bigger scale, and I think I'm becoming a little more outwardly environmentalist, a little more forward in that regard. A project I'm working on now, which I'm really excited about, is called Fires of Change. In Flagstaff, Arizona, there's the Southwest Fire Science Consortium, who is an organization that teaches fire in the Southwest to the public. They want to inform them about its role in the Southwest ecosystem, how it has its place there, and how they manage it, how things are kind of changing with climate change and all that, and civilization growing and spreading, and how things are a bit out of control, and you know, what do we do to make it, keep it a healthy part of the environment. So the consortium approached Flagstaff Arts Council, and they said, we need artists. We need artists to talk about this. So they got 10 artists, including myself, and they sent us to Flagstaff back in September for a week, and we went to the Grand Canyon, the north rim of the Grand Canyon, for a week. And we went from fire site to fire site, talking about how one fire was successful, it was healthy, it kind of worked the way it should. Yes, finishing up. And how others didn't. And so we have a year now to create a large piece for a show next September, and I'm creating a huge mural, kind of ponderosa pine forest, so it's really exciting. And I hope you enjoy the work. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, this has been a great year for jazz for us. We've had some great artists. Tonight we have the great Bobby Bradford on trumpet there. Last month we had Plaz Johnson, you know, that you would recognize his sound of the saxophone and Pink Panther. And we've had great singers here this year. One of the singers was a young lady from Korea. She was singing in the style of Sarah Vaughan. We've had Lanny Morgan with his sextet, three horns and a great rhythm section. We have a great piano. We've had some piano trios in. John Hammond, he loves the piano. A couple other piano players who just love the piano that we have here. Tonight we have something different. Another style of jazz, free improvised jazz. So I'm sure you're going to have a good time with this. And the name of the group, the Obihiro Cowboys, William Roper, he will have to explain what that means, and he has to explain to you what free jazz is, and take it away, you got it.
We are the Obihiro Cowboys. Obihiro is a town in the northern island known as Hokkaido, part of Japan, Nihon or Nippon, depending on what and where you want to say it. I spent a little time in Hokkaido. I went to a lot of towns. They call them cities, but if you're from the West, we know they towns. They're not cities. And I was happy when I got to Obihiro, because you know if you're in Japan and you go to a lot of towns, what you end up eating is a lot of fish. Fish is okay. I like fish. Fish with fins. Fish with feet. Fish with shells, it's all fine, it's beautiful, but after a while, you want some meat. And I say, you want some red meat. Because you get plenty of they call it the other white meat in Japan, known as the hog. There's lots of pig in Japan, and they eat all parts of the pig. Not unlike other people that you may know, including my people. But after all that pig and after all that fish, sometimes you want some red meat, some real red meat. And if you go to Obihiro, they have cows and you can eat some beef. Unfortunately, it's not always cooked. In fact, most of the time, it's not cooked. But you know, you have to deal with the elemental thing. Especially when you're out on the trail, you can't always get the fire going. Now, I was a Boy Scout. Yeah, I was a Boy Scout. It's not a happy part of my life. I prefer to say that I was a scout. The boy part kind of bothers me. It's all right being a Cub Scout. It's all right being a scout. I never made it to Eagle Scout because of the knots. I'd work on the knots and I'd get all tied up in those knots. But you know, I got the square knot because my neighbor, when I practiced, he used to say, "Do you know what you're doing?" And I say, "Yeah." And then he'd say, "Well, you sound kind of square." I say, well, I can tie a square knot, so it ought to be okay. It ought to be okay. So Obihiro is a cow town in the middle of Hokkaido, in the northern part of Japan. And they got cowboys up there because they got cows. If you got cows, you got cowboys. And you know, the Japanese love a lot of American stuff, and they really love cowboys. And unfortunately, I hate to say it, but I love cowboys too. Don't you? We all love cowboys. Say it, admit it, it's okay. John Wayne's over with. We don't have to worry about him, but we have our own hearts to think about it. We love cowboys. Yippee-i-yo. Kaye. Ride 'em, little doggies, ride 'em. Now, I am really a cowboy at heart, but I have to say this, and cover your ears if you must. I also like sheep. I also like sheep. I like lamb. I like to eat lamb. But as a cowboy, I'm not supposed to say that, you know, because they're competitive. So we are going to be cowboys for you tonight. And, you know, we ride the range, and riding the range is about being free. So we're going to be free. No one holds us down. We might get thrown into jail one night or two, but the night soon ends. The sun comes up, and hopefully there's no posse out there waiting for us to ride us out of town. So we're gonna hit the range, we're gonna be free. Mr. Bradford, Mr. Vlatkovich, and Mr. Mitchell. Party down. Oh, and we're gonna have a guest artist later. He's from a different part of town. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And now a word from our sponsors.
About halfway through that, I'm sitting there going like, and I have to follow this? Two words came to mind. Two words we don't always put together. Two words. Strange and wonderful. Very cool. Thank you, gentlemen. I'd like to share a little bit from a book called The Conversion of Chaplain Cohen by Herb Tarr. There's a scene on a train boarding platform. The conductor called, "All visitors off the train." "Oh, David," she hugged him to her bosom, with smells of fruits and vegetables and a mother's love. "Take care of him." These words are addressed not to Uncle Asher or even to the conductor, but to God. Tante Devora spoke to him freely and often, for the Lord, to her way of thinking, was a person sitter to whom loved ones were safely to be entrusted as her senior partner in the business of living, always accessible and invariably amendable to petitions of love. David looked at his aunt and uncle. She, with hands chapped and hard from selling fruit and vegetables, outdoors in all kinds of weather, the face ruddy and round and invariably smiling, the heavy body more accustomed to a half a dozen sweaters at one time than a single coat, the hair the color of moonlight now, but the dark eyes still bright. He, with his slight wiry body, strong and bent from lifting too many fruit and vegetable crates for too many years, the wind-burned skin, the swarthy face, impassive except for the wry mouth, the childless couple, who had taken the orphan David into their home, rearing him since the age of 7, yet refusing to be called Mama and Papa for fear that he would forget his real parents. David grabbed their rough shoulders, grabbed their peddler's hands and his smooth student ones. "How can I ever begin to repay you two for what you've done for me?" Uncle Asher spoke gently. "David, there's a saying, the love of parents goes to their children, but the love of these children goes to their children." "That's not so," David protested. "I'll always be trying to..." But Tante Devora interrupted. "David, what your Uncle Asher means as if a parent's love isn't to be paid back. It's only to be passed on." Thought about that one. My newest granddaughter was born last week. And I held her in my hands. And she looked for all the world like her mother looked 39 years ago. And her mother looked just as tired and worn out as Linda looked 39 years ago. Love is a debt you can't pay. It's only something to be passed on to another generation, another baby, a new person to love and raise. We owe a debt to all those who've gone before, who raised us, who held us when we were infants, who loved us when we were unlovable, who healed us when we were unhealable. And we pass it on. It's part of God's strange and wonderful mystery. Amen. Would you stand for the benediction? Make sure to check out the artwork on the way out the door. There are trees and things. Make sure to thank the various and sundry instruments that have been played and the marvelous gifts of the players. And go forth from this place, filled with the knowledge that God's love fills you, poured into you not only by the divine spirit, but by all of those who have been so filled with that spirit that they have bothered to pour it into you and love you. And go forth being so filled that the love of God would splash out of you and fill the world around you and pay it forward into another generation. Go forth from this place, dear friends, and change the world with your love. Amen. And
amen.
One more time.